You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host as always, Billy. We've done it. We've passed 300 episodes. So to celebrate 301, I've got the big guest. I've got the big names on the show now. I'm thinking of myself a whole already. I don't need to do that. I'm joined by the supreme, one of the hottest prospects in Scottish professional wrestling, one and only. I think I'm one of his first, if not the first, podcast interview. It's Ryan Richards. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Billy. It's great for your channel for me to be here. So let's go for it.
So you have made a brief appearance in the past in Peterhead. So thankfully, I was able to secure the monies required to get you back on to get a full interview in, because we only had like a 90-second chat, and I may have put my foot in it on that occasion. But we're okay. I've got questions prepared this time. I am all ready to go. So we're going to start with the cliche. Just the nice icebreaker. What made you a fan of professional wrestling?
Was a fan really ever since I watched it. I think it was the perfect blend of sport and entertainment. Apologies for the cliche, but seeing these larger than life characters, even from a young age, I could relate. I could see myself in them. Growing up watching a Randy Orton, watching an Edge, watching a John Cena, having that larger-than-life personality, confidently tell the world that they were the man on a live stage, even from 5-6 years old, Ryan Richards could relate to that. So as soon as I saw it, I was hooked.
It's real. It's obviously real-life theater, but theater is pantomime at the same time. But it's just, yeah, you get to see these heroes, and you're getting to see them, just like you're saying, be larger than life, be confident, and. There's always going to be a place for it, whether depending on which companies you like or support. There's always going to be a niche for you somewhere in professional wrestling. So you mentioned Orton, you mentioned Edge, you mentioned Cena. Were they your guys growing up?
Yeah, I think I always gravitated towards the big characters, the biggest personalities, people like those three, people like The Miz, a great, maybe an inspiration, maybe too far, but certainly someone that I look up to a lot. People like Alberto Del Rio, people like Randy Orton, people like Mr. Kennedy, people who were brash, who were arrogant, who were good and who weren't afraid to tell the world. They were always my guys. The smaller, hardworking, flippy guys, not for me.
Yeah, mentioned Mr. Kennedy. What a shout, what a name. That's you mentioned The Miz being an inspiration. I could see a good bit of Mr. Kennedy in there as well. I don't know if you remember, he wrestled in Inverness a few years ago. I don't know if you were able to catch him on that show. I think it was Rock and Wrestle.
Absolutely.
So, from what I'm learning there, we were in the same room because I was at that show as well. So I was in the vicinity of future greatness. I didn't even know it way back when at the Ironworks. So you did a interview a couple of years ago. I think it was during the pandemic with Scottish Wrestling Discussion, because the website's no longer active, but we nabbed all the interviews off it. So I've got a little bit of information on your upbringing, where you were from, and we've had a past guest who's up your way, Lee McRae, who we're definitely going to speak about a little bit later on. But what was it like getting into wrestling up in Dingwall? Because it's a bit out of the way from a lot of like shows and getting into seeing live wrestling. So what was it like getting into wrestling up there?
Yeah, I think it's obviously a very different experience to people that maybe growing up in Glasgow. You know, a lot of wrestlers are coming in now, maybe watched ICW for years and then made that transition. But for people like myself, people like Lee McRae, the only real access we had to it was TV. That was our wrestling. We didn't really see live wrestling. So I think you can see that big characters, that big personas with us, because that's the only wrestling we really had access to. And I think our live experience and certainly my live experience of independent wrestling was being on the shows. My first independent show, I was on it. So I think that's unique, and I think it's helped me with the mindset that I've needed to have a big start in my career. I wasn't really in awe of people. I came straight in with good self-belief and was ready.
So it's training-wise then, because up in Dingwall, you're expected your surrounding area will be like the Aberdeen or Thurso would be your kind of local, as much as possible could be local schools. But you went straight to the down central belt, Edinburgh. Was Joe Hendry School just your first choice? Is that where you went to start training?
Yeah, it was a no-brainer. I think it's so important to be working with the best and to be trained by the best. And at the time, Joe was with Ring of Honor. I think sort of, this is January 20. But I'd done stuff with TNA, World of Sport, ICW. So the opportunity to train with someone at that level was appealing. I said there's not much in terms of a school up here. There's nothing really. I mean, there's nothing within about 3 hours of my house. So I knew I was going to have to travel. I knew that was going to be a part of the gig from day one. So it was an easy choice of knowing I have to travel. Let's travel to the best place I possibly can and work with the best coach that I think is out there right now.
So you won the first class that Joe Hendry had, because I know his school started not long before all the pandemic stuff happened. So were you part of that first batch?
I was the second batch. So the first batch was, like, Sir Judas Gray, Rob Stowe. My class, the most illustrious class, with the likes of Monstrum, with Mr. Manaville, and obviously the star myself, the very, very elite class.
It's so interesting. You said January 2020, and of course, everything shut down in March 2020. And this is where a point where we saw a lot of Joe's guys started to break out through social media. The likes of yourself, certainly, Mr. Manaville did quite a bit. Not so much Judas, but a lot of Joe's guys were getting out there. Was that something that he kind of instilled upon you guys just to start getting your character, get your personality out there through these social media times while people are using it because they can't go anywhere else? Was that something that he came to you with?
Yeah, I think the key thing to remember about that time is we didn't know it was going to be 18 months without shows. You know, we thought it was going to be a couple of weeks. And then I think the first showcase was going to be about summer of 2020. So I think we first put out content. It was with the idea we're going to be back in a few weeks, and it's a way to educate the audience who we are, what we're about, and then come back a few weeks later. Obviously, that then becomes 18 months, roughly. I think Discovery's first show back was maybe September, October 21. So if we knew it would be 18 months, maybe we'd have strategized it differently. But, you know, in wrestling, you prove you're the best in the ring, but we didn't have a ring. It was the only social media. So that was the only avenue to show who you are and what you've got and try and make a name for yourself with it. And I think it was good for me because it gave me opportunities really early in my career that I wouldn't have had access to normally. For example, people coming through now, they wouldn't come through the way that I did. You know, they would have a lot more of a humble start. They wouldn't have had a year of telling everyone how good they are and putting that pressure and expectation on themselves and then going, which was fine. I'm used to that. I'm happy that. But our journey was very unique in that sense.
I mean, I loved it personally. I know that there would have been some people grumbling about all these trainees have got more promos than matches and all
never.
That. They've got
never.
Merch before they've got matches and all that kind of thing. But I loved it because I'm much like yourself. I'm up in the Northeast, so my wrestling is I'm in Elgin, so I'm probably about 3 hours away from you. In fairness, about two maybe. Hour to Inverness, hour to Dingwall. So my access to wrestling is very limited live. So I'll go to Aberdeen. I'll go if there's a show here. So I rely on things like Twitter, like Instagram, like YouTube to get to know these people. And it's worked because I think really your class, first and second class, really trendsetted the rest of Scottish wrestling, because I think since then, whether they admit it or not, I've got to know guys like Arcade Violence, who you know very well, like Casino Brutale, and all these guys that have been able to get that their personality across before you even buy a ticket and see them is so imperative now, especially cost of living crisis, because people aren't going to buy a ticket if they don't know they're going to be, if they can't guarantee they're going to be entertained. And when they see yourself and they're watching it and going, you know what, I'd like to see that guy get beat up, they bought a ticket because they've seen your personality. You know, it's fantastic. I don't think likes of yourself and the guys, the crew at Joe's school, I don't think they're going to get as much credit as they deserve for kind of starting that, the catalyst of a more social media trend. But yeah, talk about putting pressure on yourself for a year doing that. Was there a point where you did go, maybe I should space these out a little bit more? Maybe people want to actually hurt me, as opposed to have a friendly competition of wrestling, of wrestling prowess.
No, the thing with putting pressure on yourself, and we'll speak about hopefully the most high pressure situation of my career in Newcastle last year, but it forces you to be good. There's no hiding place then. If you come out on social media and say you're the future, and then you've come the first shows back and you're not in shape, you don't connect, there's your personality's not showing, you fall down straight away. You know, a lot of people say they debut now, then you kind of get that little bit of leeway the first few shows, but like my debut weekend, a Reckless on the Saturday, Discovery on the Sunday, like Discovery's an elite promotion in Europe right off the bat. If you look at the talent that was on that first show, to have my debut weekend there, it was sink or swim, and clearly I swam. But it was good to put that pressure on myself. It forced me to be good.
So just before we get back, before we speak about your first matches and going forward from there, your background, because you're, I don't want to blow smoke up your backside here, but you're a very fit man, when it comes to it's. I was speaking to Jack Morris recently, and he was talking about looking like a wrestler, and you look like a wrestler. What was your background before wrestling? Was it quite a high end sports? What was your what was your kind of background there?
Yeah, it was mainly been sport, really right from a child. Football was probably the main one, you know, coming playing teams like Ross County, but Shinty was a big one as well, which I may have a little bit of a pretty boy look, but I grew up in Shinty. I was in men's Shinty teams from 15, so I grew up in a tough way there as well, a demanding way. So fitness has always been a huge part of my life, and then coming into early 20s, knowing that I'm going to start professional wrestling, that's when the entertainment side came in, and naturally I have a background that I can lean in, and the more I talked about my background and my growing up, the more people despised it, so I leaned into that even more.
Should that talk about a rough sport, a tough sport, a shinty, because that's, yeah, that's, we don't, there's no pretty pads and stuff like that, like you would get the out in America with the American footballers and stuff like that with all their pads. When you talk about here, you got shinty, rugby, and the likes, and things like that. As far as football goes, where were you? I'm assuming lean, you're a midfielder, right?
I was striker. I
Yeah.
was the man that walked the spotlight. Surprisingly, surprisingly.
Absolute shock. Absolute shock there.
Yeah,
So let's talk about that Discovery show then, because I've just got card up in front of me, just where you're talking about high pressure and who's on that show. So of course you were a six man in the pre-show, sorry, six person, PJ nowadays, it's 2024, with Beth Shorty, Frank Gallo, Tommy Cartel, and you were teaming with Ashley Vega and Dean Mack. And this was interesting because this was the kind of start of, there was some back and forth online between Team FPWA, now Power Pro, and of course Joe Hendry School as well. So it was on a pre-show, so people had paid extra to see you guys, which, you know, pressure one. Pressure two, looking at the rest of this card here, you've got Mark Haskins on the show. You've got Kings of the North. You've got Joe on the show as well. And he was Session Moth, Ring of Honor at the time, or just off Ring of Honor at the time. After, you know, the weirdness of the 18 months, Gene Money, God, big demo, bloody hell, yeah. I mean, thank God you can handle pressure
The
because
best in
that's
Europe. The
bad.
best in Europe.
So that first match then, six man tag. How did you feel it went for you? Was it everything you expected it to be? As you mentioned, Reckless Temp being your first match, but this being on a premier Discovery Wrestling show, what was it like for you?
Well, I kind of stole the spotlight a little bit in our match. I don't know if this has been up online, but Dean Mack tagged himself in towards the end. So as he then got beaten up, got put down, as he was crawling towards our corner, went for the tag, I pull my hand away, I walk to the back, he turns around and gets pinned. So I think I made an impression on show one, but the biggest thing that happened in my career was getting on high quality shows early. Because the names you mentioned, being in the locker room with people of that quality, seeing the way they prepare, how they put everything together, bouncing ideas off them, that was the perfect thing for me so early on. I think half, roughly, of my first 10 matches of the show were in Discovery, and being surrounded by, I would say, the best in Europe at that time was the perfect thing. So I didn't see it as pressure. I saw it as an opportunity to grow and to learn and start fulfilling my potential early. So I didn't feel the pressure. I felt I was coming in with a big personality, a good connection, and yeah, being around great wrestlers and great talent was a good opportunity.
Of those first few matches, I'm seeing who your opponents were. You've got Deacon Matthews in a 6-minute Iron Man match, which, you know, I think as fans we watch it going, oh, it's only 6 minutes, but I reckon as a wrestler, that's just as pressure filled as our match, because you've got to try and do something that people will be entertained by, and of course win in the space of 6 minutes. Johnny Lyons, I love Johnny Lyons. I think he's just incredible. But on those shows, and then of course Turn Up, Scotty Totty on there. Was there anyone that you were able to gravitate to for advice that may have stuck with you going forward?
Yeah, I think after my first match, Mark Haskins pulled me aside, gave me advice. Kings of the North, they worked a lot in Discovery in 2022 in particular, so we'd always bounce ideas off them. Obviously Joe, but yeah, just real high quality talent. I think people think I'm arrogant, and yes, that is true, but I'm not too arrogant to know that people that have been there and done it can help you and assist you and give you that bits of guidance. So I'm still the same now. You know, we'll maybe talk about ICW, people like Kenny Williams and Shaw Samuels. With high quality talent, I'm always very open to getting that guidance. So yeah, 21, 22 in Discovery, there was a lot of good talent that I would speak to and get that guidance from.
And I mean, not only that, you're on shows with people who can talk to people. You know, Big Damo, of course, he's around Progress, he's around OTT and the likes of that. And Shai, you've mentioned, he's all over England as well. And Joe, especially, because a lot of his first guys came through, likes of Wrestle Carnival was one of their first matches, and that's a huge, huge platform to be on. So I like that your people will see you're arrogant, but you're not stupid. You're humble enough to go, right, I'll pick the brain of a BT gun, because he might open the pathway to iron girders. What do I need to do to get there, and the likes of that. So it's just smart, you know. We call it arrogance. It's just intelligence. If you want to open doors, you've got to go knocking at the same time. So, but no, you traveled quite a bit, just not only in the central belt, but you're able to jump about and go different places. What was it like to wrestle in Inverness? So you're against Martin McAllister at Wrestling Experience Scotland. I think it was Ironworks, wasn't it? So that's probably as near as damn it as you're going to get as a hometown match. So did you feel like, talk about pressure, so ignore that bit for a second, but did you feel there was an emotional connection to wrestling at the Ironworks?
You would think so. I think I'm maybe the most successful Highland wrestler. So you think coming home, I would get a great response. You think I would get a hero's response, maybe. Booed out the building. Booed out of the building. So it was another night in the office. It was very fun to work so close to home. And it's a shame the Ironworks closed down. It would have been good to do more shows there, especially with the way myself and Lee are running ICW now. We're dominating ICW. It'd be very cool to bring it back. But yeah, I didn't get the hero's welcome that I expected and thought I, quite frankly, deserved.
That's it, because I asked Lee the same question about it. I don't think he didn't have that much of a emotional reaction to wrestling in, like say, near a city of Inverness because of the reactions that were being provided. But you're right, as far as the Ironworks venue was, it's a shame that it shut because it was great. I loved going to the shows at the Ironworks. It was just it was a underground kind of atmosphere as opposed to some of the other family friendly venues. I know in Inverness there's some shows at Mercure, which just felt like you're wrestling in a basement in a hotel. That's because that's what it was. But no, the Ironworks was special for just the atmosphere it created, even though they booed you out the building. Yeah. But Mark McAllister is a little bit of a different opponent to the likes of you had Dalen Hendry, you've had Johnny Lyons, you had Talon Jr. as well. That's quite a variety of different styles. How do you figure out, how do you adapt? Is there any wrestlers that you watch specifically to go, right, this is how this guy adapted to a Rey Mysterio? How did this guy adapt to trying to think of a wrestler like a Chad Gable? Is there any wrestlers that you watch to kind of pick some styles off of to try and adapt to your opponents?
Yeah, all my tape study in the build-up to a match is based around that match. In terms of the guys that I would study, I think the two, or maybe the three biggest would be Del Rio, Randy Orton, and Edge, especially in the kind of late 2000s, and seeing how they would deal with, you know, with Dalen more of a submission wrestler, with Talon more of a high flyer, with Mark McAllister more of a scrappy underdog who won't stay down. So yeah, all my tape study around a match is based around my opponent. I go into great detail. My training starts to tweak that way as well. If I know that I'm facing a high flyer, I'm facing Talon, then I'll work more with high flying guys and getting that mindset. So yeah, all my focus is on my next opponent, always.
Randy Orton, that's another fantastic name bringing up. He's a guy that it was a while ago, it might have been last year or something, that I said that Randy Orton will never get the respect he deserves in his lifetime, in his career, because watching him wrestle, it's just art. He just knows. He knows what every little thing he does. It's less is more, but all he does is more at the same time. Just picking those little things up and just moving the right way. So he's a great one to pick up from. I imagine, again, as a fan, I don't think I've done anything active as that in my lifetime, so I'm just going to assume that it's I'm right, and that's the best way. But ICW, then, let's talk about ICW, because you made your debut, I've got here, as part of the Square Go entrant tournament. So ICW, that was on WWE Network at the time, Peacock. Was that? Yeah.
Right up until my first match, that was the first show that wasn't on the network.
Peacock couldn't handle Ryan Richards, clearly.
Absolutely. Couldn't afford Ryan Richards, I think, is the unofficial line.
So the prospect then, before we get went on to Fight TV and Triller and things like that, so this is the prospect of you being on a network. So, well, which would have been Triller, right? So not only were you only, just over a year in, a year and a half maybe in, and you're going to be on Fight TV wrestling and getting to show off the Supreme Ryan Richards. Again, I'm not going to keep banging on about pressure, even though it seems to be going to pop up in my brain every so often, but is there the child in you going, oh my God, this is amazing, this is so cool that I'm going to be wrestling one of my first few matches in ICW on one of the biggest networks, wrestling networks in the world? Was that a thing that came to mind?
I think for most wrestlers, they would be nervous, they would be overawed, they would feel that pressure, but I felt ready. You know, I think ICW is a huge platform. It's obviously got a lot of history, a lot of prestige, and I wanted to be a part of it. I was looking for a way in, because traditionally for people from more of the East Coast, it's difficult to break in. It's not easy to break in there. If you look at over the last few years, the wrestlers that have broken in, it's only elite wrestlers, really, the likes of myself, the likes of Jack Morris, the likes of Theodoros. So it's tough to break into. So I knew I needed to really grasp the opportunity. But again, I felt ready. I felt like I had the personality. I felt I had the physical attributes to be there. I thought I was good enough, and I proved that. And I think that's why DCT in particular saw so much in me very, very early on.
We'll definitely get on to DCT in our little timeline here, because that's, again, another very important part of the Ryan Richards story so far. So you're on ICW, you're, again, yeah, making a name for yourself. Did you find any backlash to people? Because I know ICW was going through that transition point, coming off of pandemic into the closed door shows, into the transition from WWE Network to Triller. Did you find any backlash towards you not being a atypical ICW wrestler, now being able to take advantage of these opportunities presented?
No, I never find a backlash. I think people are always jealous of my work, my abilities, but in terms of where I was from, anything, no, I think I've always conducted myself in the right way. Arrogant, but, you know, in some ways respectful. I think I was smart enough to know it's a huge product in ICW. There's so much potential there. There's so much money for us all to make with me involved. So, no, I think I enjoyed it from day one.
I think it's one of those things we've touched upon, you being just intelligent, like not being like two-faced about it, but you're very much a case of, yeah, this is an opportunity, I will be respectful and make my way through there. And then if the moment comes, and I could be a little bit arrogant, and I could be a little bit, then the time's right, I'll do it kind of thing. It's
hard not to be at times.
Yeah, I mean, in my head, I just rewatched, well, didn't rewatch, I just binged through Ted Lasso recently, and you're very much a, as far as that arrogance goes, a bit like a Jamie Tart kind of thing. I don't know if you're aware of Ted Lasso. But
you're not the first person to have said that, which is, I don't know how I feel about that.
Well, I think he's one of the elite in his sport, and he's getting the opportunities, yeah. and people think he's arrogant. I think that kind of may have sums up, maybe not the Manchester accent.
He goes through a journey in that show. Maybe Ryan Richards will go through a similar trajectory one day.
Okay, maybe
I
one day.
Count on it, but he may.
Maybe one day people will finally accept the Supreme into their lives, and they'll cheer for you. Not that you're going to care either way.
I think they should. I don't think I'm a bad guy. I think fans can either choose to, you know, like me and look up to me as maybe a bit of an inspiration, or hate on me because I'm rich, hate on me because I'm blessed. And unfortunately, they've chosen the latter.
No counted for taste. So let's talk about Soft Pro then, and then we get into the big story, because that was quite a big week for you. So Soft Pro came around the right way with Charles Douglas, again, and someone who you're very familiar with, and Thatcher Wright, who, you know, people have went, of course, they're teaming up, it's Thatcher Wright. But down in Soft Pro, a company that, this is their second reign, so they're year in, getting a huge amount of buzz, and you're taking on the name, the team of the Tory Busters, which is 2023.
Despicable, really.
2023 for you. So Soft Pro, this is an event that streamed later on. Again, heard a huge buzz, not only about the show itself, but I was seeing a lot of love for Ryan Richards as a wrestler. Maybe not so much as a personality, but, you know, again, no accounting for taste, like I said. But you being an up-and-coming wrestler, just about 2 years into the wrestling world, being on a show, that on a promotion that's, again, it's just trajectory is just huge right now, and we're going to get back to it again later on. Yeah, how's that debut in Manchester and just taking advantage of it?
Yeah, it felt like a big moment for me in my career. I've been speaking to Soul Pro for about a year, looking for that right opportunity to do business for us, do business for me, do business for them. Their promotion I rate so highly and value so highly. What they do on social media is fantastic. The people that work behind the scenes are so passionate and ambitious that they might not like to admit it, but I think I see a lot of myself in them. They probably won't love that, but they're a place that I really targeted and I wanted to work with. You know, I'm very specific about where I work. I don't work in many places. I'm not someone who goes, I want to work everywhere. I don't want to work everywhere. I want to work in a certain few bigger places. But I looked to get in there, and funding Thatcher Wright was the way in. People may disagree with that method, but It got my foot in the door there. It got me on the show with amazing talent. Once again, huge platform. But it felt a big moment to go down to Manchester where maybe people know me, maybe they don't. And to knock out the park first day was kind of par for the course at this stage. But it felt like a big moment.
It's one of those things, again, we're talking about like the pandemic stuff and Joe's guys who are just called, just lump you in that for a moment for this particular point. But you guys made your name for yourself through social media, then wrestling. And I think Soft Bros got that same reputation where they do a lot of social media content, like you mentioned, and then their shows hit out at the park. I mean, I was introduced to Soft Pro through Ian Skinner because Ian Skinner was doing so much as promotion for it. And getting himself like just blown up, and it showed that people would travel hours to go see it as well. But that was like the start of an absolute mad week for you, because that was the same week as Impact Wrestling's Gut Check. And I've spoken to a few people that have been on the Gut Check, and most of it, nearly all of it's positive. But how did you find the Gut Check experience?
A little surreal. It's the first thing of that nature I'd done. I just thought it was a really good opportunity to see exactly where you're at. Because I think with, you know, the judges, Scott, with Joe, with Gail, world-class minds, but I don't know if people have told or not, but there was a lot of TNA wrestlers there as well. So the likes of Moose, the likes of Trey, the likes of Jordan Grace. With all that talent there, when you're in the ring, if you're not at a good level, you're going to get shown up very, very quickly. And I think I just viewed it as a great test, a good opportunity to see, to analyze where I really am. So I think it's easy to fake it and easy to pretend you're somewhere where you're not. I think I just thought it was going to be a reality check either way. And I stepped up on the night. It was a great night for me. But yeah, it was a really great opportunity. And I think, I don't know if the participants are out there or not, but it'll be very interesting to look back in a few years where everyone on that Gut Check has gone, because even in the nearly year since, so many people who maybe didn't have huge names before that have really, really broken out and doing some great things.
I loved seeing the photos at the time that came out maybe a couple of weeks afterwards, and I was especially the Glasgow one, because I was sitting there, you know, big nerd here with a Scottish wrestling website, going, there's that person, there's that person, there's that person. And it was quite amazing to see the likes of say, Caleb Valhalla, like, dressed to in his gear, Viking gear, and then Judas Gray, who's got a very unique style in himself, and then yourself, suit. I just like that kind of contrast that was going around when you looked around the pictures on the hall of so many different personalities and characters and looks. It really showed what a melting pot not only Scottish wrestling is, but UK wrestling is when you see that. And for yourself, you said that you didn't really feel things like seeing these people and going, oh my God, it's that person kind of thing. But was that maybe one moment where you did go in and go, oh my God, there's Moose. I watched him on Challenge when Impact was on in my room in Dingwall kind of thing. Was that a moment you had that?
Yeah, a little. I think that the Friday was a little bit more of that, being in the locker room with them. But that night, I mean, the Gut Check in particular was the best in Europe. There was the best in Scotland, the best of Northern England, the best in Ireland, the best in Spain, the best in Germany. It was stacked. Everyone in Europe who was good was there. So it was just an opportunity to see exactly where you lie in that field. And yeah, you have to think that you belong. You know, if you get too caught up in, oh, there's that person, that person, or this other wrestler's here, that I just try and focus on myself and do what I can do. You know, I trained really hard for it. I prepared well. Obviously, we had Joe's here a little bit in the preparation, so we knew a little bit what was coming. But I was just focused on myself and just try and fulfill my potential on the night. And going into it, I thought, as long as I do myself justice, then I can live with it. And I did.
You certainly did, because you appeared on Impact Wrestling Countdown to Turning Point 2023. So this is the first UK pay-per-view in Impact Wrestling for years, for a very long time anyway. And you're in the pre-show of it, which again means people have the most access to it through things like YouTube and Impact Plus and everything that they've got going on there. And you're in a match with your team with Mike D, who won the gut check on the male side of things, teaming with Grado, who's still, I would say, the most recognisable Scottish wrestler in this current time. I mean, Joe's kind of catching up very quickly. And Rhino, former ECW champion, former hardcore champion, legend of professional wrestling. I know you're going to say that you felt like you earned it and because you put in the work to do so, but being in that moment, wrestling in front of a TNA crowd, an intense TNA crowd, Tom Campbell doing the introductions, just, yeah, how was that for you?
Yeah, it was a big moment. I want to take back 24 hours from the Thursday night the tour picked up in Glasgow. So I was at the show, front row, seeing world-class talent up close. At that point in my career, that was the highest quality show I'd seen live. And I went away from it thinking, just the Thursday night, I went away thinking, that's the standard. You know, that's what I want to get to. How do I get there? 24 hours later, I was in that TNA ring. So it was a surreal 24 hours. I only got the call on the Friday morning. So I don't think people know this, but it was about 10:30 on Friday morning. So I'm in Inverness, 10:30 on Friday morning, and I need to get to Newcastle, and we're on first. So you talk about pressure, you talk about stress. I remember I got about 2 hours down the road and there was roadworks and I was there for about an hour. I remember thinking there was genuinely a point where I thought, I'm not going to make it. I'm not going to make it. That was the most stressful day of my life. We were on first. I think we were on about 7. I got to the building after 6. Jeez. So, about pressure, you talk about stress. Yeah.
I mean, you're talking about 24 hours beforehand. You were in Glasgow the night before, so you would have went from down to Glasgow, did all the gut check stuff, then back up to Inverness, and then back down to Newcastle. That's just insane. I mean, the match time on the old cage matches here says less than 5 minutes, but I bet that at that moment was probably the best 5 minutes of your wrestling career, especially when you're sitting there going, yes, this is absolutely worth it. I mean, not with the result, take that away, but generally, yeah, all the hard work you've done, that 5 minutes must have been just exhilarating.
Yeah, it was a good moment. It was very self-affirming. You know, I put in a lot of work and took a lot of risks in my career so far. I think we touched upon it at the start with the social media stuff. Like, that could have gone badly. You know, that could have gone the complete other way where doors were closed. So I took a lot of risks, a lot of gambles, a lot of investment in my career, you know, traveling 3 hours every week, or, you know, 7 hours round trip every week. It's a lot. It's a huge investment, and it's worth it for moments like that. It felt very self-affirming, and I hope it's the start. You know, the way I look at it as, I can either be the guy that wrestled for TNA once, which is nice, or I can make sure it's the start of something. So it was a great moment. It was a great night in general, you know, to be in the locker room with Will Ospreay, with Moose, with Eric Young, world-class talent, the best in the world. And just to show that you belong there. That's the next step. So yeah, it was a great moment. But a crazy couple of days. You know, gut check was so much adrenaline, so much pressure. Then the Thursday, and then I came home Friday morning thinking, okay, I can relax. I can digest everything that's happened. You know, like on the gut check, I got so much advice from TNA wrestlers. Try and digest all this. And then down to Newcastle, crazy day. But that's what we do it for. You know, we do it for moments like that.
But you talk about your investment. And I think if you did all of that work, social media stuff, and then you debuted and you looked rubbish. Like if you didn't invest in your gear, invest in your body, invest in looking like a star, that you would be dead in the water before you've even begun. Because if you did all that stuff and then your entrance music hits and you come out and you're in a tatty singlet and off-white trainers or something like that, people would have went, ah, no, that's it. He was all talk, all no actual action. When you're crafting together your gear, of course, you've got kind of like the boxing style shorts and the gloves, and it's all white, which is always a bold move for a wrestler. Was that like purposeful, that the way you crafted your look for showing how supreme you are in the world of wrestling?
Yeah, I think the first thing is I wanted it to be different. You know, I didn't want to be just another wrestler. But the gear inspiration is Muhammad Ali. I love the confidence. People say I might not be as a great guy like he was, but I loved his confidence, his over the top arrogance. I love it. I'm inspired by it. So it's a little nod to him. And yeah, I wanted to stand out. I wanted to look different. And you talk about investment. Wrestlers don't wear white gear because it lasts one match. I have new white gear every single show. So you talk about investment, you talk about commitment. It's all in, man. It's all in. That should be the biggest flex. When I flex my wealth, it shouldn't be the car or the house. It should maybe be the gear. But
absolutely, because I mean, I got to see wrestle earlier this year, and it was pristine white. There was not a grey mark on there at all, or a bleed in the material. It was just absolutely white. So going forward from Impact, probably one of the highlights, certainly one of the highlights in your young career. You've really got your teeth into ICW. So you started a little bit DCT or David Campbell Thompson or Jackie Polo, as he may have been known at that time. It caught your eye. You caught his eye, and Victory Inc. Polo Promotions, I think it was called at the time when you initially caught your eye, into Victory Inc. He's a guy that's been around for a long time. DCT is one of those fascinating guys I would love to get on the podcast, because he started like what I'm doing, but he made it a absolute entertaining wrestling career, world champion, just did everything he wanted to do, and then once he did everything he wanted to do, left. And I think that's quite an inspiring story. But what was it like getting to travel with DCT and being able to get advice from him and that whole Victory Inc. kind of time?
Yeah, it was a no-brainer when David approached me and wanted to take me under his wing. There was a lot of young wrestlers who had won that opportunity. You know, he was a former ICW world champion, main evented lots of times, huge character on the shows, hugely successful. At that point in my career, it was a no-brainer. His psychology, his attention to detail was phenomenal. So in that maybe 6 months, I think it was, I learned a lot. I developed a lot. I think I really came into my own as a personality on screen under him. But all good things have to come to an end. And the time was right. The time was right. You say he left on his own terms. I think we would say differently.
But yeah, I can see your argument on that side of things, because it was the final Fight Club, DCT's final match. You were against him. And I think people may have looked at that and went, oh, why not this person who'd known him a bit longer? Because that 6 month run, that 6 month period is so intense for Victory Inc. And what you guys were doing, and you were running the show. Like, people can argue otherwise, but you guys were a focal point of those Fight Club shows. So going in DCT, say you do a lot of match studying, did you kind of see how DCT had kind of captured everyone's imagination, and were able to, why people were so emotional in that match and seeing you get the final pinfall and defeating DCT and packing them, sending them to Oz?
Yeah, I think he was very methodical in the way he went about things, wanted everything to mean something. Don't just throw things away. He was slower. He was calculated. So yeah, with tape study, but I learned so much being at ringside, watching his matches as well. You pick up so much. And I even have little nods to him now, the way I get into the ring. Some movements in the ring. There's still little nods and acknowledgements there. But yeah, it was a great experience for that 6 months. And I grew a lot in that time. I evolved a lot in that time. Maybe too much. Maybe I evolved too quickly. That's maybe what caused the premature end. But it was a pivotal period in my career for sure. And again, when you talk about us being all over the show, we were in multiple segments every show. We did great business during that period.
And you got to team with Lee. So of course you guys are both from the Highlands up north. So did you guys know each other? Did you cross paths before the whole wrestling training began, and before you met each other possibly on shows? Were you guys aware of each other? What was the kind of background between you two?
And also, I was introduced to Lee on ICW. He trained at GPWA, and obviously I was at Joel's school, Discovery Academy now. So I weren't aware of each other before ICW, and the first on-screen interaction we had was in DCT's last match when we'd done business behind the scenes, but that's when the on-screen reveal happened.
It must be kind of nice. I'm using such a lame phrase there. Nice to know someone who's done the same kind of thing. That as far as the travel, it came down from the Highlands, and instead of turning off to Edinburgh, they turned off to Glasgow and was doing the same kind of run. Was he a guy that you became very close to quickly because of that, and you guys were able to do a bit of the traveling together and being able to bounce off ideas very quickly because your intense short experiences?
Yeah, definitely. I think we have a similar vision of wrestling. You know, we want it to be that larger than life personalities, those big characters. And I think you can see, maybe jumping forward a little bit here, but you see the stuff we do in ICW, we come across like stars. We're not just two indie wrestlers. We come across like larger than life personalities. You know, we have a camera guy filming us walking into the building. It blows up on social media, 10,000-11,000 views just walking into the building on an independent show. It's pretty unheard of. So we have people very, very engaged in everything we do. And yeah, I think a lot of it is it's two guys with a similar vision and philosophy on wrestling. And it's, you know, we'll be skipping forward again, but it's been a knockout success, Lee joining the group.
It's great to see guys from where I am, my neck of the woods and upwards, doing so well. Yourself, Lee, Mayhem Brooks as well, being another guy who's from Murray. So, and that's not, we don't get wrestlers here. I don't know. Ian Skinner briefly, he was here as well, but moved down south and then moved even further. I think there's maybe not so much a chip on your shoulder, but the fact that you have to do all this travel kind of thing, is there a little bit in there going, I travel 7 hours at least once, twice a week, I go to do this. I need these opportunities because I need to validate that travel, and because yeah, is there anything like that that goes on? Maybe in the first couple of months of training.
Yeah, I think even now, I mean, the truth is, people may look at someone like myself and think I'm entitled, but people like myself and Lee have to work harder to get these opportunities. Training for us is not traveling 10, 20, 30 minutes down the road. It's a full day. It's long hours. You know, we're doing shows and we finish it, you know, we don't get out till midnight. We have 3-4 hours still to go. It's harder for us. So I think there is an element of you need to, I wouldn't say work harder, but I think there's an element of you can't really fail. If you're putting all this time and effort into it, failure is not an option. You can't be happy to just be on the show. You know, you want to flood it. You want to make all that time, all that money, all that investment. You want to make it worth it. So yeah, I think there is an element. You really have to push yourself more. And yeah, I think failure is not an option when you're putting that much time in.
And to strip it back a little bit further, you guys are so far up north that if a spot's available, a promoter is going to sit there and go, right, can I get a guy that's 30 minutes up the road that could do the same job as this guy who's 4 hours away, and I'm going to have to put a little bit of money aside for it to help with it or to refund expenses and stuff like that. The fact that you specifically, because I've spoke to Lee's got his own episode, we'll leave him aside for a moment, but for you, you have to have that larger than life character, because if you don't, people will fill that, someone will fill that spot like that automatically. So the fact that you've been able to do that and lynch yourself into ICW seamlessly, and you're a focal point of many segments in ICW, and the fact that you've still got to travel 5 hours to get there every month is testament to the work you've put into it, which is pretty much what you've said, but I've kind of just repeated it back to you with a little bit of rambling to throw in there as well. So yeah, just
I
again,
think you hit the nail on the head when you said convenient. It's not convenient to have me in a show. I need to make it must see. I need to be box office. I need to get bums on seats. I need to get people to be watching it online. I know that I have to do that, otherwise it's not happening. So I've always had that pressure on me. I'm used to it now. I think I've flourished in it. So yeah, I think not being convenient forces you to be good.
So we'll talk about a bit more about discovery just now, because I love that you put yourself in a position where you're on the VIP for the majority of your matches in discovery wrestling. I love that kind of, like, we'll call it elitist mentality of going, no, if you want to see me wrestle, you're paying extra to see me. You're going to see me wrestle. And I just love that. I have no other thing to talk about that. I just love that thought of no, if you're going to see me, you have to pay extra. And that's just fantastic. Was that something you went, right, no, this is happening? Or maybe someone came up to you and go, no, you're special. We're going to put you on the VIP because people need to pay to see you.
Yeah, it's to try and, again, stand out. And it's to be a feature of the show. I think you can have a spot on the VIP show to just be another match, or you can make it special, make it different, make it must-see, make it a running theme as well. I think we did a good run on the VIP shows, and every single one of them sold out. Every single one of them sold out. People wanted to see it. It was a thing. They were desperate to see me lose. When Frank Gallo, there was dubious circumstances with this, but when Frank Gallo submitted me, people were off their seats cheering, which doesn't genuinely happen in pre-show matches or VIP show match. So despite that spot, I got that engagement. I got that connection with the audience. And then when the time was right for me to come back, the connection was there to go right to the top.
Oh, yeah. Because when your match was announced for April when against Gene Money, I was seeing people just furious that you were in that match with Gene Money. And put in that position for the Y Division Championship, like going, oh no, but he lost to Frank Gallo. But the fact that you put that body of work in on the pre-show, people that could have just used that time to go get their snacks or whatever, or get their merch, but the fact that they were engaged with you, that put you into that position straight away. And it wasn't the match that ended up being advertised, because Leon Slater
got
inserted.
No, it was not.
But again, for your career, you're in the ring with Gene Money, who is wholly one of the most underrated wrestlers in the UK, in my opinion. I think he's just absolutely phenomenal. Leon Slater, who's signed with Impact Wrestling, or TNA now, signed with TNA, an absolute phenomenal wrestler, and you didn't look out of place in that triple threat. Was obviously winning the title was the most important thing, but was that also maybe up there in the top three things you wanted to achieve in that match, was to not look like you're the one with the least in-ring action out of the three?
Yes and no. I came to win that day. It was scheduled to be me and Gene. I want that Y Division Championship. I'm going to put it out there now. I'm not going to be humble. I think the list of champions that belt has is incredible. I mean, just recently we've seen Joe Hendry versus Joe Coffey on WWE TV, two former Y Division champions, Leon Slater killing it in TNA. That championship indicates you are the next guy. You are the future. And I have a slightly unhealthy obsession with that championship. I believe if Leon wasn't inserted in, and again, dubious circumstances, I believe I would have been the Y Division champion that day. So my focus now in Discovery is, again, I don't want this to be a one-off. My focus now is, how do I get back there? How do I get back to Leon Slater? And again, it's as you mentioned earlier about being intelligent. For me now, it's about being strategic. Of first of all, how do I get back there? So the last show, Discovery put me against three of their top young talent. I run through them. I'm going to do whatever I have to do to get back. But I know when I face Leon Slater a second time, because he beat me in April. Okay, I wasn't prepared and he beat me. But when I face Leon Slater a second time, I have to win. Because I know, and I need to be honest with myself here, if Leon Slater beats me a second time, there's not going to be a third. So that's my focus now, is how do I get back there and how do I beat Leon Slater to be the next Y Division champion? And there's been little alliances flirted with. You know, do I hire Rob Stowe and Monstrum? Do I go down that road? Do I bring someone else in we haven't seen? Do I do it myself? All these strategies are up in the air, but my focus over the next year in Discovery is absolutely to be the next Y Division champion.
Yeah, so for those that are unaware, that show ended with Joe Hendry, Adam Maxted, and the likes getting knocked out, and Leon Slater getting knocked down by, you call it a flirting alliance with Judas Grey and the Good Times, Rob Stowe and Monstrum, which it's such a cool thing. That was my first ever Discovery show. I'm hoping it won't be my last, but it was my first ever one, and I got to see essentially this new breed of young wrestler that came out of the pandemic standing victorious on top of a stage. It just showed what the trajectory of wrestling is right now. And it's like, you look at that, the four of you, none of you is the same. Like, one end of the extreme, yourself, to the other of Monstrum, kind of thing. And these are guys that you've grew up training with, you've grew up in the wrestling business with. Seeing everyone kind of go on their own path and their different kind of experience and their different look and their different things that they've gravitated towards, like, how does that make you feel that you your first and second class of the Joe School are just killing it in wrestling, not just in Scotland but in England? How does that make you kind of see things?
Well, yeah, I'm a big believer that iron sharpens iron. You know, to be the best, I think you've got to work with the best. And I think it's no coincidence the level of talent that's coming out of the school. You know, having an active TNA wrestler as a coach is a huge help. I think we're very blessed with that, to have Joe as a mentor. You know, I think it's quite rare to have someone who's over in America wrestling for TNA, then coming back. And we're getting that information, that knowledge, that experience live like a week later. I think it's very, very special to get that information. And I don't think it's a coincidence that everyone in that school has leveled up over the last year. Everyone's killing it. And I think it breeds healthy competition. You know, if everyone else is leveling up and everyone else is doing well, you need to keep up. You need to even get ahead. I've never wanted to be in an environment where everyone else is rubbish and I'm the best. You don't get to the top being like that. You need to work with the top talent, and so much of the top talent is coming out of that school.
It's insane. And you mentioned TNA as well, but of course the news coming out that Joe's one of the only wrestler that's got the facility of doing the TNA stuff and the WWE Performance Center. Like, pretty much he is breeding you guys to have all the tools that you need to make it to WWE and all that kind of stuff, which is incredible, and it's certainly been shown in matches when it's on Triller, when it's on live, wherever you go, you get to see these matches. We'll go for the surreal thing now, which is back to Solve Pro. So they had the right way. Solve Pro somehow, and I'm still not quite sure when I say this that I'm actually living in not in a simulation somewhere. They brought in Les Battersby from Coronation Street, and I'm still not sure this is even real. The Les Battersby's World Order, you ended up in a bit of a skirmish with them, and you end up actually getting blindsided, I'll say. I saw the footage, blindsided by Les Battersby. That has to be a fairly surreal moment in life. Not just wrestling, just in life.
Les Battersby is a ludicrous individual on every metric. Ludicrous individual. But we did great business. You know, it was the most ludicrous match I've ever been involved in, but that match hit every mainstream media newspaper. It was in The Sun, it was in the Daily Mail, it was in The Mirror, it was everywhere. The viewing figures on social media were through the roof, the engagement was through the roof. So from a perspective of a man of class and elegance, it was my worst nightmare. The banter bus, which is the most appalling name I've ever heard for a wrestling team, are ridiculous individuals. And Les on top of it with the LBWO, from a personal standpoint, you know, I'm disgusted at this, but from a business standpoint, it was very, very, very successful.
But I mean, well, around this time last year, things like Mr. Blobby was making an appearance, Dave Benson Phillips was wrestling, and it's just, I don't understand it, but I'm enthralled by the entertainment value that it brings in as well. Because was it next show had the Les Battersby World Order. They had the Butcher's Club with Ashley Peacock, and then the blue Les Battersby World Order turned up. And I just, when you're doing all these matches with the likes of Victor Inc., but they're kind of more serious competition, and you're standing there and you're watching Les Battersby wrestle, is that kind of a little bit of levity in your life that you can kind of just maybe in the back of your mind just enjoy the moment, going, I am part of something, like you're saying, that is going to go viral. I'm going to be, everyone's going to see my face, and this is just ludicrous at the same time.
Yeah, I think of the money. I know how much money Les is going to bring in. I know how much the clicks are going to get. What I don't appreciate is, you're right, he blindsided me. He absolutely blindsided me. So I didn't appreciate that, but I just react to everything that's happening. You know, I'm just Ryan Richards. I'm focused on me, and whatever ludicrous characters come in front of me, I'm just going to play off it. I'm just going to bounce off it. Crazy times. The Sub Pro crowd is crazy. It's the most non-PG, PG crowd ever. I walk to the ring and little kids are shouting F the Tories and giving me the finger. And yeah, okay, this is Manchester. Welcome to Manchester. But it's a great crowd. Very, very passionate. Very, very passionate. It's a great place to be. And I think what makes Sub Pro Sub Pro is they are ridiculous in the best way for business, but they are a ridiculous place.
I like, just going through your 3-year career, I mean, I'm going to miss out so many highlights here, but you've wrestled on pay-per-view. You've wrestled a 6-minute Iron Man match. You've wrestled, you've fought Les Battersby. Again, blindsided you. There's just no way, two ways about it. You've had the last match of one of possibly the most beloved wrestlers in Scotland in DCT. You've packed in so much in that time, and then I'm not even talking about you wrestling on a football pitch only a few weeks ago, Peterhead as well. Which, again, it's just, I can't wait for you to, I was going to say, can't wait for you to retire, but I can't wait for you to be able to look back at all the things you've done, and that's only your first 3 years in wrestling as well, and the fact that you've got 25, 30 years at least ahead of you in wrestling. Yeah, it's just fantastic. It's fascinating. And this is why I like getting guys on, maybe not so early, but like 2-3 years in, because I get to kind of see the groundwork starting. And you've got one of the most fascinating groundworks in pro wrestling so far, and it's just, yeah, mad stuff.
We talk about moments and talk about pressure. I think DCT's last match was the main event of the final Fight Club as well. You think of all the talent that's been on Fight Club over the years, all the stories, all the moments. We were the main event of the final Fight Club, and it was DCT's last match. Huge, huge moment, huge pressure again. But it's the theme, you know. I'm the man for the big moments. I thrive on them, and that was maybe one of the biggest moments of last year for me. Maybe even the biggest. That was a huge, huge moment, a huge night. It couldn't go wrong. That night couldn't go wrong with Lee coming in. With what we needed to retire DCT. It was the last Fight Club that was live as well. Huge moment.
And going forward then, so unless I've missed out anything particularly imperative, I mean, people go back and watch matches on Triller, because like you say, you don't you're very selective of where you wrestle. You're not a weekend warrior. You're not going to just pile in loads of matches just willy-nilly. But going forward, is there places that you've got an eye on, that you're keeping tabs on? I mean, off the top of my head, I'm assuming Progress, Rev Pro, places like that. But is there promotions that you've got like on your horizon that you're maybe in negotiations with that you can give us a little tease for?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm always thinking what's next. I think in terms of the UK, I've done most that I want to. I think the bigger goals are further afield. But in terms of the UK, I think Progress is certainly one. I think maybe something that's on ITV is another. I think there's something that's maybe rumbling in Scotland as well. Someone that helped me very, very early in my career. Maybe something rumbling there. So again, yeah, very selective, but I'm always looking at what's the next opportunity? Where's there good business to be had? Where can we create moments and engage the fans and make money? Wherever we can make money and do great business, I'm going to be interested.
The fact that we're spoilt now with wrestling, Scottish wrestlers have like a limited potential and opportunities if they go to and ask these places. Because again, mentioned chat with Jack Morris, he got into Japan because he asked, he just inquired, and there he was, and there he is in the N1 killing it. Is that something, again, if the money's right, Japan, is that something that you've aspired to? I don't know if you're a big fan of the Japanese style wrestling. I know because you got into it through the WWE style of wrestling, of the big entertainment, the big characters. But is Japan something that you'd be intrigued by?
I don't think Japan fits my style. If I'm being honest, I think the American and UK style fit me more. I wouldn't like to go somewhere and change. But what I do want to mention is I think Jack Morris is a phenomenal example for any young wrestler coming through. Someone that looks the part, talks the part, conducts himself the right way. He was someone that was on shows with me very early. So like those early Reckless shows, Discovery shows. A great person in the locker room, a great mentor, someone that I think young wrestlers should really, really look up to. Just the physique, the way he talks, the way he performs. I think, a great example and an inspiration.
And of course, speaking of Iron Sharpens Iron, you were on Clash Weekend, you wrestled at ICW After Hours. You're on night two. Drew appeared on night one. Were you there? Were you able to grab him aside, pick his brain? I'm doubting it because it seemed to be a very busy weekend for him anyway, but were you able to try and grab a word from him to try and soak some of that experience from him at all?
No, he was very quick and in and out, but I think the fact that he showed up is very telling for the business that ICW is doing right now. I think there was other WWE superstars there as well, Carmelo Hayes, Grayson Waller behind the scenes. People want to be involved. People want to see what ICW is doing. I think it's a huge compliment that Drew showed up an hour, 2 hours after main event in SmackDown at the Hydro. I think it's a real testament to what ICW is doing, that people at that level still want to be involved. And yeah, I think it's very special that that's happening. And it was a great weekend of business in general. It was two sold out shows. The crowd at stupid o'clock in the morning were so hot. They were so into the matches. I think my match was 2:30 a.m. and they were as loud as any crowd I've seen in this island. So that was an amazing weekend of business.
So going forward, then, we mentioned places you want to go to. Do you have opponents? You mentioned Iron Sharpens Iron. That seems to be a little thing that's popped up in a few episodes now on this podcast. But who's on your horizon for doing that, for raising you just a level above each time? Is there anyone in particular that just you've got your eye on that you want to do that, to try and elevate yourself further?
I think in Discovery, I want Leon. There's one man I want. In ICW, we want to do the biggest business that we possibly can. We want to be the biggest box office stars in ICW. That's what Victory Incorporated want to be. We see ourselves as almost the Harvard of ICW, an exclusive group that everybody wants in, but is very, very tough to break into. So the likes of Jack Jester, the likes of Grado, I think, I want those big matches, the Sha Samuels, those larger-than-life characters. I think you put us alongside those type of characters in the garage, I think it sells out. I think it does great business. I think people are captivated by it. I think we're in an era where people want those big personalities and big characters facing off, and I think we fit that perfectly with Victory Incorporated, and I think that's the next step for us. You know, we need to put down Shay. Shay, we've beaten him a lot. You know, Shay is doing some amazing things all over Europe, but every time he faces us, we slap him down, we put him down, and at Bard, 1st of September, we need to finally put an end to Shay Monet. And then we need to go into the biggest, most box office matches that we possibly can.
That seems like a perfect way to start rounding up then. So just before we finish up and do all the social media and all that kind of stuff, what's it like sharing a locker room with Denise? Is she as intense as I imagine?
She is every bit as chaotic as you might expect.
Perfect. Right, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me. Where can people find out more about Ryan Richards the Victory Incorporated, just everything that you want us mere mortals to get on and stream and make money for you.
Yeah, absolutely. Instagram and X is RyanRichards1_, and we are live on Fight every month as well. So tune in there, pause and engage as much as we can on social media. I think it's a huge part of wrestling, and as much as I may look down on the fans, the engagement is encouraged. I think it does great business for us all.
Great, perfect. Thank you very much.
Thank you.